I kindly invite Professor Victor Caradi to discuss these five interesting papers. I briefly introduce you, Professor Victor Caradi, but all of us know his curriculum vitae. Victor Caradi is professor of history at Central Europe University in Hungary. After having been research director and emeritus research director at the Centre National, at the Centre National de la Recherche Scientifique, and a member of the Centre de Sociologie Européenne. His interest and research activity in historical sociology cover the following main topics: the birth and academic institutionalization of French sociology, elite training in France in the post-Napoleonic universities, ethnic and denominational inequality in Central European elite schooling, social selection of students in pre-1948 Hungarian university, social history of European Jewry in modern times. His special expertise extends over the study of East-West student exchanges, the formation of professional brackets, and the role of educational capital in the legitimation of ruling elites before and under communism. Theme leader since 2003 of a large-scale cooperating research project on elite training in Hungary in the 20th century, funded by the Hungarian Agency for the Support of Research and Innovation. He has also won Award Team Leadership Grant in 2008 from the European Research Council on elite formation in multicultural East Central European societies. He is the author of several books and contributions translated in 10 languages. Please, Professor Caradi.
Thank you very much. I have a very difficult task because I was looking for connections between the five papers which you have listened to, and I found not much in terms of connections. So I'm going to talk about each paper shortly, especially raising questions which are interesting within each of the papers. At least I'll try to do my best in this sense. So the first paper by my friend Peter Thibault-Noyd comes out of a study which we are conducting together on Hungarian social sciences since particularly the Second World War, but going back to the earlier situation, that is, to the early 20th century. Now, there are two big problems in Peter Thibault's presentation, of which he gave the theoretical rationale, so to say, but unfortunately didn't have the time to give you the details of his results, because he has very interesting empirical results. Some of the basic data he showed you in a couple of sketches of tables, not real tables, but he has an enormous data bank of something like 14,000 people, that is 14,000 persons identified as having contributed by publications to social science disciplines in Hungary since the early 20th century. So he couldn't present this, the preliminary results. But the main problem he touched upon has to do with two points. First, you have a central problem of the formation of educated middle class in Hungary, but this is, I think, typical to several Central European countries, that is, the division between an established traditional and Christian elite, educated intellectual elite, and the newcomers. The newcomers, he mentioned some of the newcomers. The main newcomers were, of course, since the late 19th century, the Jews. And then you have in countries like Hungary, but also in countries like the Czechoslovakia, a very important German contribution to the formation of national elites. So this is the first big problem. We have happily very good empirical database on the formation of this elite, because we have built up, thanks to the grant we received some 5 or 6 years ago from the European Research Council, we have built up a complete database on on university graduates from the late 19th century up to the early communist times. So we have covered everybody prosopographically, individually, with basic standardized biographies. In this prosopographical database, we have practically everyone. So if one identifies, like Peter Thibault has done in his work, the reputational elite part of whatever group he's interested in. We were interested in the social sciences, so identified people who have published on the social sciences and who figure in various capacities in encyclopedia or other sources. We can draw back on the basic standardized prosopography of graduates, of university and high school graduates, and we can identify basic individual information about them, like religion, ethnic background, German, Hungarian, Slav, whatever. We have data on father's profession for the largest parts of this prosopographical data bank, and we have also data on their educational career. So the combination of the two sources, the academic sources, archives, and the source on social science, members of social science establishments, can be combined and give results which hopefully will be ready in a couple of months to be presented on a larger scale. Now, the second problem area he touched upon is this problem of normal elite, normal intellectual procedures and normal science as against the innovative, creative, revolutionary science, scientific innovation, and people who produced scientific innovation. And this second aspect can be approached by the same databases, because he could identify both sides, the people established in universities up to 45 and even after 45, and people who were outside universities but publishing on social science issues. So we could reach both parts of this clientele. So the very reasons, the very sources of innovation in the social sciences could be identified via the people who produced them, okay, who were responsible for them. So I think it's a very important initiative Peter Thibault has presented to us. Okay, now the second study by Anya Jabour, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce your name, is a very different study, as you have heard. It's a local case study on women in a major American university. It's a very rich and detailed presentation of the place of and everyday life of female students in a male-dominated academic environment. And it's a kind of anthropological approach of sorts, because it shows you a pattern of inclusion without integration. I mean, there is a level of integration, but in a separate institutional pattern, in a separate women's college. So it's a very interesting pattern, which has the double objective, apparently, of protection of women and promotion in the same time, academic promotion. At the first part, the protection part, is well illustrated in Anna Jabour's study. I think that the second part, the promotion, is much less illustrated, because for this one should have had some ideas, some information about careers. What happened to these women? What were the conditions of their academic achievement? What kind of degrees they got? And how these degrees compare with the male academic clientele? So for that kind of basic comparison, one would have liked to have more information. Anyhow, what's interesting in this study, that it reminds us that in the development of feminization of post-First World War and even late 19th century, it started in the late 19th century, universities in Europe and elsewhere in the world, you have at least two patterns. One is this American, Anglo-Saxon, Canadian pattern of basic social separation of the first promotions of first classes of women in universities, while you have the European pattern, the French, the German, the Swiss, and Central European pattern, where there is no separation. There are no specific female institutions in universities. There is a formal and informal integration of female students into university life, full stop. So these two patterns are interesting to be compared, and maybe and it would be interesting to draw conclusions about the achievements of each pattern, the protected separate pattern and the integration pattern, okay? Okay, so once again, a very interesting case study of this first American type pattern. Now, Jung study is a very classical study, I think, very important one on racism and political purges in Nazi German university, in a case study of Hanover Technical University. It's a classical problem area which immediately gives us some cues about the setup of the pre-Nazi university. For example, the fact that you said that 21% of university staff was purged shows that there must have been at least 21% of people who were not considered as responding to Nazi expectations, which is, of course, very low in one sense. But in another sense, it shows you that if, for example, the 21% includes at least half of Jews, that there was an extraordinary Jewish over-representation in German university staffs up to the Nazis, which is quite, well, I won't say astonishing, still astonishing, because you have a very large over-representation of Jews everywhere in Central Europe among students, but not necessarily among professors. You would find something similar in places like Hungary, Romania, or Poland in the same period, or in the Baltic states in the same period. So this is a German specificity, given the fact that in Germany at that time you had maybe 1% of Jews in the population. So this shows you the very specific local German effect of the specific Jewish trend of modernization, which exceeded similar trends in the rest of society. Anyhow, the basic facts are worth to be looked at more closely. And I'm still wondering if anybody has some similar data on the Italian universities, that is part of the Jews in Italian university staff, because that could be a clue about the similar issue in Germany. We have very precise data on Central Europe and in the Baltic states, but they are less interesting because you didn't have this strong presence because of Jews in university staff, because they were simply not admitted. They were admitted among students, but not among the staff. So once again, it must be a German specificity. Another important issue is, of course, the issue of purges on the one hand, and the fact that the universities, in spite of Nazification, could have a rather significant leverage, that is, to deal with their own appointments. The ministry was imposing or tried to impose scholars, but the ministry, in spite of the Führer Prinzip, didn't have absolute power to impose people in the staff. Universities had a negotiating power, which they made use of. And so it's interesting, for example, it would be interesting to compare the Italian universities with the German universities in this respect. The vested individual power of the university authorities as against the state power. No, it's just an open question I'm raising, but anyhow, it's interesting to remember that even in the worst situation, in the Nazi dictatorship, individual established prestigious institutions could, to some extent, keep a level of autonomy and make respect their own principles. Okay. Now, you have the two Italian studies to go to the local situation. Are both very interesting. Alba Lazarezzo's study on Padua after the Second World War is a very deeply documented case study of the post-fascist rebuilding of the second classical and most prestigious Italian university. And it's based, well, the study is based on mostly on minutes of the faculty council's meetings. Now, the problems touched upon among those in which I was interested more deeply has to do with the anti-fascist backlash. That is, on the one hand, the university was marked as one of the outstanding places of resistance against fascism, against Nazis particularly. And on the other hand, there was, as you have explained, no systematic readmission of the of the incaricati, for example, to university staff. So, and no discussion about the expulsion of Jews, for example, in 1938. No systematic, recognition of this extraordinary criminal fact of life, that people were expelled from the university, from their career, from their academic positions for racial reasons. So the two are interesting to be reflected upon, and I wonder what was the reason, of both. That is, on the one hand, it's just a pure question. Did Padua have any specific Freemason connections, that is, connection with the liberal, with this highly liberal establishment of Freemasonry, to have this anti-fascist past or anti-fascist references? Or are there other reasons, other conditions which explain this anti-fascist past? Of course, the anti-fascist past includes the fact that the 20 staff suspended, were readmitted very quickly, just like in Germany. So this implication of Nazism, fascism in university life was forgotten about. So in both cases, it's worth to be reflected, and it would be interesting to compare, of course, this forced oblivion of this compromising connection with the dictatorial past in other countries, especially in communist countries, because in communist countries you have something comparable that once earlier fascists declare themselves as good communists, their past could have been forgotten about quite easily. Now, in democratic countries or countries in a process of democratization, it could have been more difficult, but apparently it was not more difficult than that. Anyhow, comparisons here would be welcome. I have this interesting little data concerning the prizes which some university staff could receive in the early 50s. And you mentioned that the university ruled that prizes could be accepted only if the man or women had published one study during the year of the reception of the prizes. Well, this is on the one hand insignificant, on the other hand it's very significant because it shows that nevertheless demand for research and publication of research results was not very heavy in the university in these years. Because one publication in a year is really not a very heavy load of intellectual performance. Okay. Now, some other aspects of university life are also worth to be mentioned here. The harassment of junior students. One wonders whether it's a very old tradition. It might be a very old tradition. You know, it happened in most traditional universities where there is a continuity from pre-modern and modern times that such harassment is ritually achieved, ritually realized. One wonders whether it's some old type ritual. It's also interesting to note that Padua University received private grants in this period. That raises the question, since what time was this usual practice? Because in some university systems, like in the French system, up to the end of the 19th century, this could not happen. No private grants could be given to the faculties because there was no university, no unified institution to receive such grants. Okay, so, well, those are detailed questions of details into which I don't want to go. I just remind you that these questions might be interesting in a comparative scheme. Finally, the last lecture raises for me basic problems, methodological problems, I should say, because it's, on the one hand, very interesting to see that Alessandro Breccia is doing a prosopographical foundation of his research. But one would like to have the size and the real shape of this prosopographical enterprise to, for example, to know how many people are concerned, how many people are in the prosopography, and what are precisely the criteria of selection of those who are dealt with here. And one would have liked to have a minimum of quantified data, because if you give personal, individual biographical data saying that some people left, some deans left, and others, like in Pisa, if I understand well, did not leave in 68, then one says, so what? Well, yes, some decided that way, some decided the other way. One doesn't see any connection between what happened in the student world in 68 and what were the options for the staff, especially the leading staff of the university. So for this, one would need some kind of quantification and some kind of organization of these anecdotically looking individual biographical informations, okay? And if you have this basic hypothesis of generational change, then you have to study the generation. That is, you have to go beyond those included, those involved in the student revolt, but you have to deal with the others who were not involved and compare the two. So otherwise you can't get out of the methodological problem, okay? I would add some other questions which appear to be very important. I don't know the Italian universities, but I know a little bit the French universities because I was lived there in Paris, the 68 student movement. And at least three, four basic changes did happen in France. I wonder if they happened in Italy too. One is the recomposition of the whole political scenery in the country following the 68 revolution, which has started already earlier with the decline of the Communist Party, among other things. But this is something very general and which goes back once again to the earlier period. Now, you have a basic institutional change inside university organization. You have a university reform law, which really redeveloped universities on a different basis than before, cutting up, among other things, Paris University into 12 separate universities. So there was a basic institutional transformation. Then you have fundamental changes in the social life of the university students. This is the period from which people were saying vous. But this is trivial, but something very significant because it appeared immediately after the 68 revolution. There was a significant change, transformation, to the benefit of students, of power relations within the universities, power relations between the staff and students, but also between the members of the staff, members of various status within the staff. So I wonder whether this happened in Italy too. It would have been interesting to do there again some level of comparison between cases like France, Germany, of course, and Italy or other countries. Okay, so thank you very much. This was a very shortcut remarks about the papers we have heard.
Thank you, Professor Cardi.